я не знаю. Может быть. Вот, хорошо, значит, то, что я собираюсь рассказывать реально, это некий новый формализм в квантовой теории. А то, с чего я начну, это то, из чего произошло на самом деле, то, из чего произошла эта работа. На самом деле я начал с того, что я попытался написать некий текст на тему о том, как я понимаю квантовую теорию. И основные мысли вот займут первые несколько минут моего доклада. А после того, как я написал этот текст, я понял, что то, что там написано, дает некий другой формализм квантовой теории. И вот о нем, собственно, я и буду рассказывать, но это будет после первых нескольких минут. Значит, первое высказывание, основное, что я думаю про квантовую теорию, это то, что квантовая теория – это... О, я должен говорить по-английски. Хорошо, хорошо. Нет, я, как говорится... Хорошо. So, the first thing that I should say about quantum theory, this is, it is a completely deterministic theory. If you know this state at moment t, and you know the Hamiltonian, you can predict everything at any time. So, and, my statement is basically that quantum theory doesn't require any interpretation. It is completely independent theory, and the probabilities that appear in this theory, they appear precisely the same way as in statistical physics. They appear from random environment. So what will be explained in the main part of the seminar is how these probabilities can be obtained, and this is something that they are obtained from something that is called the coherence. I will explain in some way the coherence stuff. But also I would like to say something about particles in quantum theory. The notion of particle in quantum theory is a secondary notion. It can be defined. The notion of elementary particle simply doesn't exist. Really, there are theories that can be written in two different ways. In one way, you have some particles appear to be elementary, and another particles are composite particles, and other particles are composite particles. In another formulation, composite particles are elementary, and elementary are composite.
You mean weak and strong coupling duality?
So basically, I mean, there are examples like Sine-Gordon theory, and where you have.
But by quantum field theory, you didn't give a definition of quantum field theory, so it's not Lagrangian.
No, it's not Lagrangian quantum field theory at all. So that's quantum field theory, simply quantum mechanics, when you have also some translation invariance, some spatial translation invariance. Not more than that. This is the next slide. The thing that I wanted to say that a very clear picture of quantum theory can be interpreted in completely classical way when you have solitons in your theory. There is a large class of theories where classical theories where there exist some particle-like solutions of equations of motion. For example, soliton. Soliton is a finite energy solution of the form S of x minus vt, which means that you have a bump, a moving bump that doesn't change its shape with time. Also, you can have generalized solitons, where the bump is moving with some constant average speed, but it is breathing, it is oscillating. Sometimes it's called breather. But anyway, if the theory doesn't have any solitons or generalized solitons, then the standard picture will be as follows. You have some state, some initial data, and you have the standard picture is that wave packet it is spreading for larger domain, and this means that the amplitudes goes down, and if you have the situation when non-linear term is for small values of amplitudes is smaller than linear term. This is the standard situation. Then basically you should expect that this time you will have really some almost linear solution. People consider some classical nonlinear scattering in this situation. However, if you have solitons, this doesn't happen, of course. But what do you get, really? You will get from any initial data, at the end you will get some superpositions of solitons plus some almost linear tail. And basically this means that you can consider scattering of solitons, and the end, in the middle of the process, you will have something that doesn't, it is not similar to any particle-like solutions. But after that, the solitons reappear, maybe with some non-linear, with some linear tail, almost linear tail. And this is precisely what happens in quantum theory. You have particles, after that you have something that doesn't resemble particles, and then you have particles again. So, probably. So basically, what you should expect in this situation in classical and in quantum theory is that you will have some interpretation in terms of particles in the beginning and in the end, but not in the in the middle. So, and except especially clear, this is when you have topological charge. For example, if you have magnetic monopoles, then you have some conservation topological integrals of motion. So it's basically in this situation, classical picture is very similar to quantum, and moreover, quantizing this picture, the classical picture, you will have very similar quantum picture. This situation is very well known in this audience, especially. It is very well known in the case of one spatial dimension. But in the case of, and when you are working with integrable systems. But it is true when system is not integrable also. And moreover, there are experimental confirmation of it in higher dimensions also. So basically, next slide. Basically, I will forget about this stuff right now, and I will go to another topic that I already mentioned, the appearance of probabilities in quantum theory. And what I will do, I will say, I will consider a very general situation that from the very beginning doesn't have anything in common with quantum theory. And later we will see that something very similar to quantum theory does appear. So, the next slide. So what I will do, I will give, I will explain some geometric approach to quantum theory, to quantum theory, or maybe to any physical theory. I will the starting point is here will be the space of states, the set of states. I will show how to derive the probabilities, and this derivation can be applied to standard quantum theory. After that, I will describe the relation to Jordan algebras. And I finish with several remarks about scattering about particles and scattering in this theory. Next slide. I will start with probably this some standard stuff that if you thought quantum mechanics, probably you started with these remarks. And the standard in quantum mechanics, as in almost any physical theory, you can consider a notion of state in a definite moment of time. State at the moment t. In any physical theory, you can consider a notion of mixed state. Mixed state is a mixture of several states. States appear with some probabilities. And this is not specific for quantum mechanics at all. It appears, for example, in economics, in Gacy, in game theory, where the analog notion of state is strategy, and you have pure strategies and mixed strategies. So basically, you should consider mixed states. And the first remark is that, of course, mixed states, that I will call states, starting this moment, they form a convex set. So the starting point of quantum mechanics and any physical theory, almost any physical theory, is a convex set of states. Now you should have some dynamics, should predict what happens with time. Okay, it is clear the dynamics is described by some evolution operator. Evolution operator should, if you would like to have invertibility in time, the evolution operator should transform your set of states into itself. You should have some automorphisms of the set of states. So maybe not all of them. So you should have some group of automorphisms. Instead of set of states, you can consider cone of states. Basically, this is the same formally mathematic, but usually it is convenient to consider states that are normalized and states that are not normalized. So then they are defined up to a factor, positive numerical factor, and then you have a cone of states. But this is simply another language. You have some notion of observable, think that, and it should be a linear functional on the set of states. Next slide. Next slide. So, and the dynamics is really specified by some equation that gives you evolution for small period of time. If state is evolution operator is sigma of t, then it satisfies the equation d sigma over dt is equal to some operator h applied to sigma. And I wrote imaginary unit in front of the derivative, but it is really simply conventional stuff. It is absolutely unnecessary. Next slide. The examples are standard examples. If you have classical mechanics, then the space of states is the cone of states is the set of finite measures on some symplectic manifold. But you can, instead of this cone of states, you can consider set of normalized states, normalizing the measures based by the condition that the measure of symplectic manifold is equal to 1. The group of automorphisms is the group of canonical transformations of symplectomorphisms. Observables are simply functions on symplectic manifold. Slide. In quantum mechanics, there is standard quantum mechanics where a state is a density matrix, a positive operator of trace class, having trace equal to 1. But also you can consider a cone of states without, when you remove this normalization condition, trace is finite, but not necessarily equal to 1. And the equation, you know, for density matrix, the equation can be written as commutator, as commutator with self-adjoint operator, the group of automorphisms. This is a group of unitary operators in Hilbert space, which acts naturally on states of density matrices. Next slide. There is another approach to quantum mechanics, where the main is algebraic approach, where the main notion, the starting point, is an algebra with an involution. Observables are self-adjoint elements. Its states are positive functionals, functionals that satisfy the condition that apply to A star A. It gives a non-negative number. And this is a cone of states, but if you impose the condition that omega of 1 is equal to 1, then you have normalized state. Next slide. So I should say that it was understood 80 years ago or so by Jordan, by Jordan in English, that really, this formulation is not really very reasonable from physical viewpoint, because multiplication of observables doesn't give you an observable. Multiplication of self-adjoint product of self-adjoint operator is not self-adjoint anymore. So and therefore, Jordan suggested that you should introduce a new operation, anti-commutator, AB plus BA. Sometimes it's multiplied by 1/2. It doesn't matter. And this operator, this operation already being applied to two observables gives again an observable. So therefore, for physics, really, Jordan algebras, Jordanova algebra in Russian, it is much more natural. Next slide. So, and we will see that in the geometric approach that I am advocating, the Jordan algebras really appear quite naturally. So this is a very long introduction. Now let me go to real part. What I am saying is the following. It is reasonable to start with a set of states, which is a convex set that I assume to be bounded. So in standard quantum mechanics, you also start with Hilbert spaces, you consider a set of states, but as I try to explain it in my talk in Vyshka, it is really not, it isn't sufficient. So I'm starting with some space of states, set of states, and also I am assuming that there are evolution operators that belong to some group that I denoted by script V. So this, knowing this group, I can write down the equation of motion that defines, that specifies the evolution operator. This equation of motion has standard form, where H is an element of Lie algebra of the group V. This is something that plays the role of Hamiltonian. Next. So, as I have said already, the case of standard quantum mechanics, this operator H is a commutator with some self-adjoint operator. solicitous, almost no conditions. I will impose one more condition, that this operator, H, has discrete spectrum. And I will show, maybe a little bit more, and I will show that is sufficient already to derive probabilities to say that in my theory probabilities appear in natural way and in this theory and therefore in standard quantum mechanics probabilities should not be introduced by hand. They should be derived. Next. So what I am assuming that this operator H has a complete system of eigenvectors with eigenvalues that I denoted by epsilon j, and it can be proven very easily that this epsilon j, this eigenvalues, are real. This follows from my assumption that the set of states is bounded. If epsilon j is not real, the evolution operator will be unbounded. It cannot act in bounded set. The evolution operator will be bounded, but the set of evolution operators would be unbounded. What I would like to. How do I want to get these probabilities? My statement that I started with, really, that probabilities appear precisely in the same way as in statistical physics. They appear from random environment. You should imagine a molecule, atom, and you see that you always have some interaction with stuff around. You can have, for example, you can have a microwave oven in the building nearby, and it already gives you some perturbation. You can have an atom that this trajectory that is closer, or even not very close, to your atom. Again, you have some perturbation. And what I would like to, how do I want to consider this formally? I will say that simply that a Hamiltonian of my system that I consider is changing a little bit. Moreover, I will assume that this change is adiabatic. So we have Hamiltonian H depending on T, and the derivative of this Hamiltonian with respect to T is really very small. So I will, this will be my interpretation of random environment. And I will look what happens with my system. It will be, it is, I will assume that basically what happens? I will assume that my Hamiltonian depends on some parameter g, maybe on several parameters, doesn't matter. And the dependence of time is described in the following way. G depends on T. And this dependence is adiabatic. G prime is the derivative of G with respect to T. T is very small. And I consider this H of G of T. And I'm looking what happens. So really, it is clear that this new Hamiltonian will have different eigenfunctions and eigenvalues that I denote by psi I of G. And if you take the origin, if you take the original basis psi I in appropriate way, you should change it a little bit. Then you can assume the dependence of I with respect to G will be continuous, even differential, even analytic for small g. I assume that there is a small deformation of Hamiltonian. So and then I can apply what is called adiabatic perturbation theory to this picture to solve the evolution equation. Next slide. And here the adiabatic theory, the adiabatic perturbation theory is even simpler than in quantum mechanics, because in quantum mechanics, you know, the stationary states are defined only as any states, are defined only up to a factor. And here, you don't have this problem. So basically, you can do, you can solve this, you can write the solution of this equation in adiabatic approximation. It's simply wave function, eigenvalue will be multiplied by something. And it is easy to check that in the case if this phase factor, the derivative of this phase factor is equal to energy, to epsilon, then and you allow yourself to neglect the derivative of G, you will see that this is a solution of the evolution equation. That's it. Now, look what happens. Until now, I considered this Hamiltonian H of t, which was a fixed Hamiltonian. Now I will consider this Hamiltonian to be a random Hamiltonian. And then, of course, you will, the state that you obtain should be taken as average with respect to this probability distribution of Hamiltonians. And you will see that these phase factors, in general, simply will give you zero in the limit. Basically, what do we have? So I do not want to give a proof. It is easy to impose some conditions on these Hamiltonians to get more or less rigorous proof. But really, what do we have? You have these phase factors, random phase factors. And the average of these random phase factors gives you zero, except one situation, when these phase factors really are not random, they are basically what do you get? It is possible that your original epsilon is equal to zero. You have a zero mod of the operator H. And it remains zero when you change epsilon. I call it robust zero mod. If epsilon is equal to, if you have this situation, if you have robust zero mod, then your phase factor is a constant. And nothing happens when you average. What do you get? At the very end, you really, you see that all these guys, the coefficients in front of eigenvectors, they disappear, they vanish after taking the average, except zero modes, robust zero modes. This is the situation in very general setting. There's no quantum mechanics here yet, but it is already. Because look, what happens in the standard quantum mechanics? Next slide. So I will this will be explained on really on the next slide. Here I say this slide is about a little bit more general situation. What did I do here? I considered evolution operator. Evolution and I looked at this averaging. What did I get? I got this situation that everything except Rabat Zero Mods is killed. In this slide I am saying that really you can apply this stuff not only to the energy, but to any physical quantity. The definition are as follows. Instead of Hamiltonian, instead of energy, you can take any operator A, also acting on in this linear space where my convex set is located. And also I am taking some functional small a. In this case, also I can introduce a notion of Rabat zero mod of A and apply already, this is a definition, not a theorem, apply all the stuff to any capital A, any physical quantity, generalizing the stuff that was proven for Hamiltonians. Next slide. Next one. I can apply this was a very general picture, but this can be applied to quantum mechanics. Let us suppose that I have Hamiltonian, standard, usual Hamiltonian, not my generalized Hamiltonian, usual Hamiltonian, having discrete spectrum. Then this operator H that I have considered will be considered as a commutator of H hat, usual Hamiltonian, with density matrix. And then it is clear that eigenvalues of this commutator operator, H without hat, are simply differences of eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian H hat. And then you can see that really if you write down everything in H hat representation, you will see that Rabat zero modes, they correspond to diagonal stuff, to diagonal entries. Can you conclude from my general consideration in the case of standard quantum mechanics, that interaction with the environment kills non-diagonal entries of density matrix as you should have. This is called the coherence in quantum mechanics, and in the old Copenhagen representation This is called collapse of wave function. So right now what I would like to do, I would like to give a formula for the operator that appears in my calculations. So remember that it was denoted by P prime in the slides. And this operator P prime that describes the interaction, this environment, it kills all non-robust zero modes and all non-zero modes. What can sometimes it is useful is to consider a little bit different operator that can be written in explicitly. So it is written here as a limit of 1 divided by t integral of 0 to t, to t, and then you have evolution operator. You integrate evolution operator applied to some vector. It is clear that this operator kills all non-zero modes and keeps intact all zero modes. So, basically, in the case if all zero modes are robust, then this operator P coincides with the operator P prime that we introduced. And basically, you can calculate the probabilities in the following way. You apply in general P prime, here the operator P, to something. And then you will get some state that should be decomposed into pure states. Pure states are extreme states, extreme points of convex set. And so this decomposition gives you precisely the probabilities you are interested in. Next slide. So, what did I say is a completely general picture. Start with any convex set, and you can formulate some physics that is generalization of quantum mechanics. What I would like to say is that this picture is very good in the description of physics corresponding to Jordan algebra. And this is because in Jordan algebra you have a natural notion of positive corner. So, first of all, I should explain what is Jordan algebra. I have explained already that Jordan algebra is a generalization of the following picture. You take you take an associative algebra with involution, you take positive elements, self-adjoint elements, and you take operation AB plus BA, multiplied by 1/2 if you want. You get some algebra, but what are the what would be the precise definition of algebras of this kind? The simplest definition is as follows. Jordan algebra is a commutative but non-associative algebra that has a unit. It is a unit of algebra and has the property that every subalgebra, unit of subalgebra, generated by one element is associative. You can describe, could write down some other identities, but they can be derived from this property that I... So?
Every subalgebra is generated by how many elements?
It's a unital subalgebra generated by one element. You can say that it's generated by 1 and A, if you would like. But one is... So. You have... Sorry?
Is it in any non-associative algebra this property holds?
No. 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 It is really a requirement.
Is that A squared times A is not the same as A times A squared?
Yeah. It's non-associative algebra.
Okay.
So? Yeah. No, that's. But anyway,
the algebra is commutative.
So?
Yeah, we consider commutative algebras.
Yeah.
Then we generate something by unit and one element. It will always be associative.
No. It will be only in the case with this definition of Jordan algebra.
I have to think of it.
Что-то он говорит, я не могу понять. Вы можете перевести?
Я никогда не могу его понять. Тут только Миша Финкельберг. Миша здесь?
Спит.
Ничего не поделаешь.
Окей. There is a lot of Jordan algebras that we already know. Every for every associative algebra with involution, the set of self-adjoint elements is a Jordan algebra, and so that's. And these Jordan algebras are called special. It's not very.
Jordan algebras, which come from associative.
Yeah, they're called special.
The
think it's...
So? No, 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 they are called exceptional. This is very, very, very unfortunate terminology, but I did not invent it. I cannot do anything.
Special
and exception.
No ordinary.
No ordinary. So. Next. So. So. And in the next slide, I am giving a definition of a cone in Jordan algebra. And the definition can be given the following way. Cone consists of all squares. However, it is not clear that this is a cone. But I will give another definition that shows that this is really a good. In some cases it will be clear that you get a cone this way. There is another thing that I would before going to this stuff. Would like to say another thing. So that really there is a theorem that shows that in the algebraic approach to quantum theory, Jordan algebras are relevant, and this theorem belongs to Alfson and Schulz, and this theorem can be formulated in the following way. If you have two C star algebras with isomorphic cones of states, then they are isomorphic as Jordan algebras. So geometry of cone of states in any C star algebra is reflected only by its Jordan structure.
What should be an isomorphism between cones of states? As metric spaces, as what?
No, it's as cones. One to one, it is a map. There is a cone of states, and there is a map, one to one map, from one cone to another cone.
Linear map.
That's all. So basically this means that, yes, Jordan algebras is something that you should look at in physics.
So we start from C-star algebras, which are associative, then we forget about this and consider them as Jordan algebras with respect to any given data.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is there an example of non-isomorphic?
Example of what? Sorry, this is a good question. I do not know it. I do not know this example. I have not answered, but I do not. I am not an expert in this field. Next slide. Next slide. So the good theory of quants can be formulated not for general Jordan algebra, but for Jordan Banach algebras that are defined by these formulas, this first of all, this Banach algebra. And the second, there are two more conditions that really, these conditions exclude the case when a sum of squares is equal to zero. If sum of squares is equal to zero, of course, it cannot be reasonable notion of con. You will get some contradiction. But if you impose this condition, then you really can consider the operator of left or right as commutative algebra multiplication by A, then you will get some operator, this operator LA. You can impose condition that its spectrum is non-negative. And one can prove that this condition is equivalent to the condition that you are working, that A is a square. But if you are able to prove this, you will see that it's, that really you have a con, because the condition that you have imposed is really a convex condition. So it, you can see that the set of squares is really a convex set. We are working over real numbers.
But before you wrote Schrodinger equation, and there was pi.
Well, this is, many years ago, I have a conversation with Zeldovich, I said that this I is completely irrelevant. He said, yes, we should write a paper about this. I said that I cannot write a paper with such a trivial statement. no, I is a completely irrelevant stuff. You really can write down the Schrödinger equation as dpsi dt is equal to apsi, where a is a skewer joint operator. And then it is completely meaningful over real numbers. Nothing, simply physicist put in the definition Lie algebra of Lie algebra, physicists put an I. Mathematicians do not do this. So therefore, for mathematicians, this is not a question. You can work with skewer joint operators instead of writing I. So, next. So, after that, so for finite dimensional stuff, this is this JB algebras are really what is called Euclidean Jordan algebras that were considered 80 years ago and classified by Jordan, von Neumann, and Wigner. This I will explain this classification in a moment, but at this moment I would like to say that in this classification there exists only one simple Jordan algebra that is not special, which is exceptional. It is 27 dimensional algebra that was analyzed by Albert, and sometimes it's called Albert algebra. Really, for this special algebras, one can describe robust zero modes. And the description is given on this slide. Robust zero modes should be defined for infinitesimal operators. For here, the group that I denoted by script V is the group of automorphism of Jordan algebra. Infinitesimal automorphisms are derivations. There is a large class of derivations that can be described as commutators with self-adjoint, with skew-adjoint operators. It is easy to check that commutator of skewer joint operator and self-adjoint operator is self-adjoint again. And this is what's infinitesimal automorphism or derivation. And you can describe robust zero modes there. They are simply even functions of the operator that used to define the derivation. there exists this exceptional Jordan algebra. In this case, a generic derivation has three robust zero modes. Next slide. So now I would like to talk about relation of Jordan algebras to homogeneous cones. So really, what is a homogeneous cone? If you consider a cone, then you can consider its automorphisms. This is much larger object than automorphisms of set of normalized states. And if these automorphisms act transitively on the interior of the cone, on the open part of the cone, then one says that a cone is homogeneous. And the theorem is that these cones in JB algebras are always homogeneous. And this is, and I even sketched the proof of this statement, this proof is this proof goes as follows. So really, you can define a triple product in Jordan algebra by the formula in the last line. And you can define operator in the taking in this triple product two guys to be equal. You can prove that this formula gives you an automorphism of a cone. And moreover, it is easy to see that if you take x equal to 1, this simply will be a squared. And so this means basically that you can get any square from 1. And because cone consists of squares, you have transitivity of the action. So, next slide. Now, if you have finite dimensions, Jordan algebras, then one can prove that this cone of states will be self-dual. There is a notion of dual cone. Self-dual means the dual equal to original cone. And therefore, self-dual homogeneous cones are in one-to-one correspondence with the algebras that were described by Jordan, von Neumann and Richter. And so I even can give the description of all these cones. That's easy. so really there is a round cone. There are cones of positive matrices in real complex or quaternionic case. And there is this exceptional 27-dimensional cone that goes really from octonions. So this is the description for several cones, but really Weinberg described all cones that are homogeneous and finite dimensional. And basically every cone of this kind can be used to describe some quantum mechanics and quotation marks.
Does surrealism have some meaning for quantum mechanics?
So at least you can, if you take any cone, you can define observables, you can define probabilities, you can consider Hamiltonians. The only thing that is not clear that this stuff is really has any relation to physics.
What will be the relation between the theory defined with the cone and with the dual cone?
I don't know this.
What happens if it's
maybe even they are maybe even they are equivalent. I don't know.
Maybe you have some examples.
This is only this very, very fresh stuff. Several examples of what? There are many examples. It is very easy to write down examples. The only problem is to say that your examples have something to do with physics. This is difficult. The other stuff is that's easy. What's the time? Now the last slide. What can you? This is something. I expected that I will have no time really for this stuff, and therefore this is the last slide. What can I say? That basically, I describe something generalizing quantum mechanics. What can I say? That in this setting, I can define more or less everything that can be formulated in standard quantum theory. I can say what does it mean that I have a particle or quasi-particle. The definitions sort of I think that mostly this slide coincides with a slide of my talk in Vyshka. The main thing that I would like to say at this moment is simply that everything that I did say in this talk can be generalized to this very general setting. You can define particles, you can define inclusive scattering matrix. You cannot define usual scattering matrix. I do not know such a definition. So really, notion of inclusive scattering matrix is really necessary in this setting. You can define green functions. You can express increasing scattering matrix in terms of green functions. Good times or so?
Maybe it's the same question as this. When you speak about automorphisms of a comb,
yeah,
which structure should an automorphism preserve?
It should be a linear map that specifies the one-to-one map of Conan to itself.
And only linear properties?
Linear map, not more than that. What is no Hilbert spaces here? Not so. It's really.
I've been always suspecting that some metric properties are hidden, but
no. What does mean hidden? No. Of course they are hidden, but very far away.
Okay. Yeah. As far as I understood, the main result is that we have formulated the quantum mechanics without a Hilbert space, with only a Banach structure.
No Banach structure. Even no Banach structure. Only the structure. Basically, you have if you have a convex set, required is bounded. And this is basically you have already. You can ask all questions of quantum mechanics and quantum field theory. Yes, quantum field theory. This means that you need also translate space translations. This is the.